Hey everybody, thank you so much for the opportunity for us just to come together and talk about the foundations of the Bible, the foundations of Scripture. And I want to start, whenever I heard about this topic that I was being asked to speak about, I thought of a particular verse in Psalms that I want us to go to. But before we even do that, I want us just to pause for a moment as we're talking about the power of God's Word and realize that it is the author of the book that actually brings the book to life. And so we just invite Him to illuminate our time together. Lord, thank you for the power of your Spirit. I thank you, Lord, that the presence of God prevails in our lives as we surrender ourselves more readily to you. I ask, Lord, that you would have your way in these few moments that we have. You would lead us in our discussion following, just to really understand the very heart of God and the purpose behind so much of why you have entrusted Scripture to our care. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. The foundations of the Bible. Psalms chapter 11, verse 3 says, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? So even if we walk in this place of righteousness before the Lord with devotion to His Word, if the foundations are not in place, then what can the righteous do? And so it was just so amazing. I had this situation where a young couple came in and they met with me, began to share with me a very dismal, difficult situation. And that situation in the conversation grew worse and worse and worse until it really honestly became what I would say is one of the top three most difficult, multi-layered, disappointing, despondent even situations I have ever heard in years of pastoral counseling. I'm sure many of you have heard people share difficult stories, but this one was just like at the top of the chain, within the top three of all. But you can't just look at them and say, wow, you're right, this is horrible. Like, this is the top three worst situations I've ever heard in my life. Thanks for coming in. Have a great day. You know, that wasn't an option. So pastorally, I was just trying to think through, what should I say? How should I respond? What advice could I give? And I just felt like the Lord was asking me, just empty yourself of yourself and invite me into that moment. And so I did something unusual, just pausing for a moment with them rather than rushing to pastoral rhetoric. And I suddenly felt the Lord giving me a verse of Scripture. It was an Old Testament verse, and I wasn't familiar with what it would say, but I felt the reference came. And since it was like Old Testament, I was a little nervous, and so I didn't immediately say something. I was thinking about, what if I turn to this and it says that a nagging spouse is like a leaking faucet or something? You know, what would you do then? But in that moment, I just felt, again, the Lord reiterating. And so I paused and said, look, I feel like the Lord's prompting me with something. And I got up and pulled a Bible down from my bookshelf. And I went to this reference, and it fit beautifully for them. It was a specific verse. It wasn't like a powerhouse verse, but it really was exactly what they needed in that moment in time. I learned something that day as I realized in my own pride, in my own self-sufficiency, I have been willing to have meetings with people as if I'm the one that's giving them advice to help solve their problems. And just inviting the Lord in that moment really helped me see just how important it is that He not be in the room and me spend time talking about Him, but for Him to be in the room and for me to invite Him into the conversation. And I think this is the way of life God's wanting us all to comprehend and understand. And we do that as we walk through just spending time alone with God, getting in His Word, and again, not just reading the book, but learning to sit with the author. But the Scripture becomes that foundational scenario that exists within our lives, upon which our the structure of our lives begin to be really stabilized. I actually left that Bible out of my bookcase. It's on the table in my office to remind me when people come into the room to make sure that we're relying on the Lord, inviting Him in to what he's desiring to say in those moments. It really, what I'm talking about is simply purposing the table of the Lord. And the table of the Lord is where we find the bread of the Lord, his broken body, his shed blood, as he invited us into the table of the Lord, where Jesus is our friend, where God is our Father, where we interact with God in such a powerful and wonderful way. And the table of the Lord was really important to Jesus in his earthly ministry. And I noticed this as I just kind of looked through the book of Luke. In Luke 5, Jesus is eating with tax collectors and sinners in the home of Levi. So here he is at a table in Luke 5. He's at a table in Luke 7 as he's anointed at the home of Simon during a meal. He's at a table in Luke 9, the table of the Lord to the 5,000 as he feeds the 5,000. And there he is in a meal scenario, even in that large crowd. The next chapter in Luke 10, Jesus eats in the home of Martha and Mary again at a table. Luke 11, Jesus condemns Pharisees and teachers of the law at a meal in Luke 11, at a table. Luke 14, I mean, this is progression all the way through. Luke 14, Jesus is at a meal when he urges people to invite the poor to their meals rather than just their friends. Luke 19, Jesus invites himself to dinner with Zacchaeus. I'm gonna come to your table. Luke 22, the Last Supper, the famous table of the portraits and paintings everywhere. Luke 24, the risen Christ then is alive, risen from the grave, and now having a meal with disciples. It seemed like Jesus was either at a meal, coming from a meal, or going to a meal through the progression of his life as an earthly ministry. And I just think it's significant that we recognize the power of the table. I thought it was interesting when I studied Nehemiah one time and I realized part of the way he built was to invite people to his table, officials and dignitaries. He invited them to the table. Clearly, the table of the Lord and the bread of the Lord and the fellowship of God around his word is an important part of what God's desiring for us to understand. It's interesting to me, in the first few chapters of the book of Genesis, it was all ruined for humanity by a meal that was eaten without God. And in the last few chapters, we read in the book of Revelation of the marriage supper of the Lamb, and we'll again be around the table having a meal. Purposing to find our way into intimate communion with God in Scripture is really how we learn personally, consistently, even tenaciously to come to the table of the Lord. It's in this place of communion with God, in his word, where we're really established and prepared for more of what we will face in the world, not knowing what might be ahead. We've walked through a very difficult year this past year, but in the midst of it all, God has been faithful. And the more established we were in his word, the stronger we were through the course of the storm, which brings me back to the scripture, Psalms 11:3, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? And Jesus actually explained the importance of a foundation in Mark chapter 7, and I'm not sure we fully understand when we read this story what he's pointing to. And what I felt like was revealed out of this is about a foundational reality that God wants to establish in all of our lives. It's Matthew 7, verse 24 says, "Therefore, anyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the foundation of rock." And two verses later, "Everyone who hears these words of mine and doesn't put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the foundation of sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." What we have to understand is the house didn't fall because of the storm. The house fell because of the lack of foundation. And that's why it's so important that we allow God to establish foundational theology and strength of life and what we believe that really matters, that we allow God to establish that within our lives so that we can endure the storms with an ever-present strength in the presence of God that comes from his word. I was really shocked to see the comparison of a 7.0 magnitude earthquake that hit in San Francisco versus a 7.0 magnitude earthquake that hit in Haiti. And tragically, in San Francisco, 63 people were killed when a 7.0 earthquake hit. But even wild, just more so tragic, the 7.0 earthquake hit in Haiti, and it wasn't 63 people that would be killed. It was 316,000 people. And the reason is because of the absence of structure that needed to be in place as one of the primary focal points that they pointed to when they examined the poorly constructed facilities and buildings that people were in and so on, as opposed to the better constructed buildings in another part of the world. And so just with that in mind, this is the statement I want to just challenge you to think about as we go into discussion. This will be a big part of it. Biblically impoverished people live poorly constructed lives. The more biblically impoverished we are, the more we're trying to do it on our own, not allowing His word to establish and develop and really equip us to be who He's called us to be. I'll say it again. Biblically impoverished people live poorly constructed lives. I want to conclude just by challenging you to consider finding verses of Scripture that are what I would say are passion verses that you can memorize and meditate on and read and just rehearse. I keep all of my screenshots in my phone. I just make screenshots of different verses and so on, and I just keep them in different directories. And when I'm sitting in an office, maybe waiting on a doctor, I've got a few moments, and instead of just thumbing through on social media, which I'm quite guilty of many times, sometimes I'll just press in and say, you know, I'm just going to reflect on some of these verses that I've prepared that are easily accessible. So I want to just challenge you that God would deepen our passion and our love for His Word. And one of the first verses I would point you to is Psalms 119, verse 20. Just such a beautiful chapter with 160 plus verses in this chapter. I actually went through and circled everywhere in that chapter once that references the word, precept, word, truth, whatever that may be. And I was amazed, more than one per verse that chapter references God's word. But this particular verse out of that chapter, Psalms 119 verse 20, says, "My soul is consumed with longing for your laws at all times." It's just such a beautiful expression of David's passion for God's word and what God was revealing to humanity on his journey. I would encourage you in three other portions of Scripture. We call them at our church the Psalms divide by two. 4 divided by 2, 6 divided by 2, and 8 divided by 2. That would be 42, 63, and 84. So Psalms 42, of course, is the famous, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? Psalm 63, O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Psalms 84, how lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. This is the famous text. Better is one day in your courts, Lord, than a thousand elsewhere. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. So may the Lord awaken a hunger within us and a passion to know Him and to explore His word that builds a foundation in our lives, that we might be able to endure every storm that could ever come our way. Amen and amen. Father, I thank you for the power of your word and the anointing of your spirit. I thank you, Lord, for all those listening today. I pray that as we step into a space of discussion, that out of our conversation, we would find even a sense of confirmation of what you're desiring to reveal as you deepen our love and our passion and our dependency on the power of God's word. Amen.